Next topic is reducing the burden, CV burden, time to build the CAC. So it's not Dr. C. Dr. S. Venkatraman doesn't need introduction. He's very well known. He's my teacher also. But I want to tell a few words about people with diabetes. Mostly they have mortality due to cardiovascular disease. I had an opportunity to do a study in Apollo Hospital with Professor Seshagaru, and we found out the same. And Professor Venkatraman is the apt person because he's the person who looks like a model for reducing the cardiovascular disease. And reducing cardiovascular disease is very difficult because I advise my patient to eat less cream from the curd. So I advise her, remove the cream and eat. So what she did was, she removed the cream and she ate only cream and left the curd. So we had to be very careful while giving.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Thanks, chairpersons. And of course, being part of the scientific committee for which free hand has been given by GVK for Krishna, Anand and myself, I think we insinuate ourselves for some of the topics that we find we have been identified with in the last few years, and that's why Shruti is there and Krishna is going to follow me and I am here. Now coming back to the subject, the time given is about 10 minutes, maybe part of the organizing committee can have a leverage of another 2 to 3 minutes, provided the chairpersons agree. But before I go on to the slides, I would like to start with a very pertinent question. Why do we treat diabetes? Treat type 2 diabetes, of course, for improving the quality of life, glucotoxicity, etc., in the long term to prevent the vascular complications. Microvascular, the issue is very clear. Macrovascular, yes. Strategy-based trials, starting from the UKPDS, the DCC, the ACCARD, the ADVANCE, VADT, have not thrown conclusive evidence that good glycemic control at that point of time is beneficial. On the other hand, it has enabled us to draw an hypothesis wherein good glycemic control in the early part of the disease is able to have some influence probably on the endothelial dysfunction, progression of atherosclerosis, which might in the long run be translated into benefits which we have seen. Whereas subsequently, molecular-based trials have shown cardiovascular benefits, both with respect to the SGLT2 inhibitors as well as the GLP-1 receptor agonists. So much so, the organizations throughout the world have issued a guideline that people with established atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease should be a candidate for either of these molecules. If they have cardiac failure, certainly an SGLT2 inhibitor, and if they do not have either a GLP-1 or an SGLT2 inhibitor. So the issue is, people who have established cardiovascular disease have been recommended to be candidates for either of these two molecules as per the recommendation, which has been dictated by the compelling data of the various cardiovascular outcome trials. Now the question is, in the 8 to 10 minutes, I'm going to touch upon some exploratory aspects of these trials, especially the EMPA-RUG outcome, and try to answer a question. If somebody has an event, a myocardial infarction, he has established atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Somebody who doesn't have a disease, who has been a diabetic for X number of years, hypertensive, dyslipidemia, the treadmill is positive, or you do a CT angio, there is a 70% occlusion, he is not, as per the definition of the various trial population, a candidate who has had an event, but who you and I know that he is going to be a candidate for an event in the near future. How do we categorize him? Do we deny him the benefits of the molecule which has been found to be effective in the patients with events, number one? And number two, even in the so-called trials, when we say that 99% or 100% of the population have had a cardiovascular disease, was it the event, or instead of the event, some of the other markers, for example, a CT angio or an AB index were taken, which means a subset of the population, the so-called trials, including the EMPA-RUG outcome, were not candidates, 99% or 100% did not have an MI or stroke, but they had some manifestation of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, which raises the question,
whether atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease is a continuum, which we believe it is. So this is just to start with. When you have diabetes, the longevity is reduced. When you have diabetes with an event like an MI, it is further reduced. And compared to diabetes, down. If you're going to have other diseases, the end points, then certainly you can see the odds ratio of the life expectancy being reduced enormously, which is not surprising. It is very, very logical. Let me spend some time on this profile of a patient, a diabetic of 6 years, BMI 27, BP is so much, he has got microalbuminuria, his creatinine is normal, he has dyslipidemia. He is treadmill positive. Now, if you go by the standard recommendations, probably he is not a candidate for atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, but he has got evidence of subclinical atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. He might have an MI tomorrow, or 2 years down the line, or 5 years down the line, or a stroke. So, if you assess the risk is huge. He has not had a heaven event, he has diabetes and the comorbid conditions, his 10-year risk is so high compared to somebody who does not have any of those comorbid conditions. So this, we have got a lot of evidences. There are compelling demographic data and the huge exploratory data to suggest that the atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease in a diabetic is a continuum. This is just to have some data from the nurse's health study. If you have a surrogate marker, like for example, carotid intima thickness, endothelial dysfunction, whatever it is, which is taken as a marker for atherosclerosis, then we find that subjects with diabetes and metabolic syndrome have certain values. People with diabetes have got 2 to 3 times much more risk of entities of subclinical atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, and our patient in question probably will fit into any of these categories. This is just to say that the hospitalization and the death from cardiovascular disease has fortunately seen a downward trend, maybe with better identification of diabetes diagnosis, more important the comorbid conditions, more aggressive treatment, etc., etc., but still there is a residual risk. This is what I was harping on. Strategy-based trials like what we have sent inconclusive signals with respect to the macrovascular disease, whereas with respect to the macrovascular disease, the EMPIRE outcome as well as the subsequent cardiovascular outcome trials with the SGLT2 inhibitors and also the the GLP-1 receptor agonists have shown a couple of molecules to be associated with cardiovascular mortality. You remember we started the discussion highlighting how the association of diabetes and an MI, taken as a prototype of a macrovascular event, can have a detrimental impact on the life expectancy. In this context, it is quite interesting and we are jubilant that we have a couple of class of molecules which are able to have a 38% reduction and a 22% reduction in cardiovascular mortality. So this made the AD and ASD recommendations to include that when ASCVD predominates, consider one of these molecules. And with respect to the SGLT2 inhibitors, as a class, whether it is EMPA, DAPA, or CANA, the beneficial effect driven for the cardiac hospitalization for cardiac failure has been proved consistently, so that they are excellent drugs for heart failure. But the question that we are going to talk about today, which is more relevant, is with respect to the cardiovascular mortality. I'll just run through some of the slides for the want of time because... So again, if you go to the EMPIRE outcome, which I'm going to focus for the next 5 minutes with respect to the cardiovascular death, then if you look here, the CV mortality, the absolute reduction is 38%. The relative reduction, the absolute reduction is 2.2%. This enables you to calculate the number needed to treat. at least from the point of view of clinicians, we go by the absolute risk reduction and the NNT. Maybe Krishna has got some more statistical points up his mind to question even the number needed to treat, but it makes an important comparison among the contemporary molecules, how you can impact the death in the diabetic population with the comorbid conditions, the renal benefits, the hospital cardiac failure, as I told you, probably is a class effect. Hospitalization for cardiac failure as well as the renal benefits is a class effect. We have the credence data. I'm not going to discuss in detail about it, but as a class effect these two have, but when it comes to the cardiovascular mortality, is it a class effect or is it only with respect to the empagliflozin? If it is a class effect, if it's not a class effect only with EMPA, do patients who have only an event are beneficial, or is there any data that you can extrapolate to recommend this class of molecule to people of diabetes who have you have something like a spectrum of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, and at one end of the spectrum are the manifestations of the disease. This is just to highlight the all-cause mortality with respect to empagliflozin, I'm sure, and cardiovascular mortality. Of course, CV mortality or component of the primary 3 MACE. Here, irrespective of the HbA1c in baseline, there have been benefits with respect to the CV mortality reduction. A point about this, and then I'll go to the conclusion. Conventionally, when you talk about the EMPA-REG outcome, we always say 99% of the patients with the EMPA-REG outcome are patients with cardiovascular disease. 2/3 of them had an MI or a stroke, whereas more than 1/3 had a single vessel disease, 50% luminal narrowing, plus provocable ischemia, probably slightly similar to the patient that we started with. A diabetic with a BP and a dyslipidemia with TMT positive. So it could be argued favorably in the sense that the patient in question that I started with had a profile which was part of the EMPA-REG outcome, so it makes sense to consider usage of these molecules, especially if this patient is going to have other aspects which are indications for SGLT2 therapy, for example, body weight reduction, HbA1c reduction, vascular and renal benefits. So, 1/3 of the benefits did not have a prior CV event or stroke in the EMPA-REG outcome, and then these are the various subgroup analysis which was found to be beneficial, this particular molecule. So I'll straight away go on to the slide which I thought it will impress all of you and then conclude. Of course, there have been real world data with respect to the cardiac failure, I'm not touching upon it. This is what I wanted to tell. Among the molecules which have been there available now with respect to the prevention of cardiovascular death, probably what has been much more patronized by the cardiologists quite justifiably is the sagubitril-valsartan combination which many of us are using. 31 patients need to be treated for about more than 2.5 years, less than 2.5 years to prevent one death, whereas with respect to empagliflozin, 46 patients have to be treated for 3 years. In fact, with respect to the cardiovascular death, I repeat, it is with respect to the cardiovascular death, I think this molecule compares as much as a specific cardiac drug, number one, and number two, patients who have got subclinical cardiovascular disease, like the Vignette patient that I discussed with you, will be candidates for this mode of therapy. Thank you.